Oliver, and thank you everyone for having us here at your wonderful university. I'm excited to be in your beautiful country to share my story and how DNA has impacted my life as a survivor. I also want to take a moment to thank this wonderful and elite team that I have the privilege of sharing with on this journey. This is Chris Aston, Keith Kennedy, and Safan Oliver. I've met some wonderful people. I've also met a new brotherhood. The passion that they have for DNA forensics is unbelievable. To know that a group of people would forsake their safety, their families, their own, for a greater good, a greater cause of helping not just their own community, their own state, but other countries to find solace and comfort in helping families raise the dead, literally, as Huffine will show you, capturing the innocent, capturing the guilty and freeing the innocent of crimes they didn't commit. This means so much to me to find such a group of elite people that have such a passion for this, and I'm grateful to be a part of that family. When I first accepted this assignment, I didn't know what to expect. And now that I've been here and I've witnessed what I have seen, I'm still without words, and I'm excited to still share with you guys. I am living in a master. As you can see, I am a loving mother and wife for over 20 years. I have one son on my business. I'm an author, a book, Breathe Again. I'm a writer, a public speaker, a sexual assault survivor. I used to be a victim, but now I am a survivor. I am now a victim's advocate as well as a DNA advocate. And what I decided to do today, I've changed up a little bit about my story and how I'm going to do my story if I'm going to read it from my book. The night was July 31st, 1985. The adult tech retired upstairs for the night while my siblings, our cousins, and myself watched downstairs television before we all fell asleep. As we set up, we laughed and played a little while longer, and before long, one by one, we all began to drift off into sleep. I lay on the couch letting the television watch me as I listened to the humming of the box fan and felt the calming in the room before I finally fell into a deep sleep. I always had a tendency to sleep on my right side with my back facing the floor with my face towards the back of the couch. Wake up, turn over, are the next words that I heard. As I turned over, I tried to focus and gain some sense of what was going on. Now lying flat on my back, I realized that I did not know this person and that was standing over me. And before I was able to respond or react to the stranger, a knife was thrust under my throat as I lay on my back in total confusion. I had no idea who this person was or what they wanted as I lay there in total darkness. I began to try and adjust my vision to the dim light from the television. I found this to be very difficult because now my eyes had begun to swell up with tears as I was demanded to close my eyes. During all this sudden terror, I managed to ask, "Who are you?" With tears now streaming down my face and sobbing uncontrollably, to be only told, "Shut up." Now with a faint and trembling voice, I then asked, "What do you want from me?" And the only response I got again was, "Shut up." Now this stranger thrust his knife deeper and harder into my throat. Next he took his knee and began to force my legs apart, so then I began to give him a struggle, because I did not know exactly what he was trying to do, but I had an idea. Suddenly I noticed that he was unloosening his pants with the other hand and knew that without a doubt this man was indeed trying to rape me. So as I struggled with my attacker, my entire 13 years of living had flashed before my eyes like a motion picture on a dim movie screen. As I lay there in total fear, I knew that this would be the night that my life would be taken by the hands of a stranger. Mama, which is what I call my grandmother, used to always tell me that I had the gift of persuasion and could possibly talk myself out of anything. Because of this, she also thought that I would be a good lawyer or a better doctor. So before I would allow this assault to happen, I began to think of ways that I could talk myself out of this predicament. So out of desperation, I told the attacker that I was about to scream, but he told us I did, he would kill one of the kids on the floor. How can anyone be so cruel? I remember thinking, as my heart began to sink. I loved my little brother and sister, and the idea that they looked up to me. They were all I had. I was not only their big sister they had looked up to, but I was the one that helped them with their homework and was the sole guardian when we went out to play. I could not imagine us no longer being able to play Mother May Day, Red Light, Green Light, or Simon Says together. My little sister especially loved it when we climbed trees together while my little brother would always giggle and give himself away and hide and seek. Then there were my little cousin who was just toddlers, and the thought of someone taking all their lives because of me was not only unthinkable but unacceptable. So in another failed attempt to try and stop my attacker, I told him that my daddy would be downstairs at any moment to go to work and that he had a big gun. The daddy that I spoke of was actually my stepfather, and honestly, I don't know if he even knew how to hold a gun, let alone own one. I was only 13 years old, and in my mind, I thought this was destined to scare him away. Instead, I was thrust up upon even harder and was told, oh yeah, and if your daddy come down upstairs, then I will shoot him with his 357. Now, after another yet failed attempt, I was more than terrified. I had a stranger on top of me murdering my innocence as he held a knife to my throat. The stranger not only held my life in balance, he threatened the life of my beloved family. So there I lay completely helpless and alone while being overpowered and abused, and all I could do was cry. I remember crying so hard and uncontrollably that I began to hyperventilate and could hardly breathe. Suddenly, from out of nowhere, this imbecile had the audacity to ask me my age. And for a moment, I thought, you've got to be kidding me. Here you are raping an innocent child and you're asking my age? So in an attempt to make him feel some sort of guilt for his actions, I replied, 12. Still to this day, I wish I could have said I was 9 or 10 because honestly, that's how young I looked. Furthermore, I believe, and I was told, as long as you were not in your teens, you were still considered a small child. Don't ask me why I thought that, because I lied my age that a racist would all of a sudden develop a conscience or display some sort of character to stop it and assault and walk away. I guess that was part of my way of thinking as a child, that in the end, if given the opportunity, people would do the right thing. Damn, was his only reply as he continued to rape and inflict excruciating pain upon me. I remember telling the police that my attacker assaulted me for about 20 minutes, although it may have been short. It seemed as though he was on top of me, tormenting me for hours. As I lay there with my clothes ripped from my body and drowning in my tears and my own blood, my mind began to reflect back on my grandmother and how she used to always be my saving grace. Mama feared no man, not even death, and taught us that the only thing we would ever fear and surrender was the Lord. Mama also installed in me that if we were any kind of trouble, to call the name of Jesus. You see, she believed that there is power in the name of Jesus, and just by calling on his name, that he could do and heal and deliver you from anything. I believed it because I believed in my grandmother, and I had watched her in her faith conquer many things. Although she may have meant what she said in a literal sense, I took it in the extreme and cried, Jesus, right there while the beast was on top of me. And without hesitation and much frustration, he immediately snapped back, shut up. While ignoring him completely, I then began to make a plea for my spiritual savior. I remember saying, Lord, if you deliver me from this, I promise you that I will serve you until I die. At that time, this was a sincere prayer, and I had made up my mind that this phrase was not going to have a final say-so in my survival. Although I was still uncertain of my fate, I was sure of my destiny, and that was that I would see Jesus and Mama again one day, and soon the stranger was to kill me. Who are you talking to? He asked, with great anger in his voice, as he thrust his knife even deeper into my throat, but I continued to pray now almost in a murmur. Forgive me, Lord, for all my sins and all the bad things I have done wrong. Please let my family know that I still love them and always will. I said, shut up, he snapped back again. He then snapped and yanked me up and reminded me that he had reached his family and he would use it. He then told me that he knew who lived there and knew all of my family was upstairs, and if I better had not opened my eyes or said anything until he left. Then he said, well, I had better not call the police because he was watching me and waiting nearby to see if they would come, and if so, he returned to kill me. Next, he grabbed me again and slapped me in the face and cursed on the couch and told me to lie face down and not say a word. There I lay face down with my nakedness uncovered and my innocence lost forever. My mind was racing a hundred miles an hour as I was wondering, was he really going to let me live or was it a trick to see if I would move before he would kill me? I couldn't see if the children were okay because now the television was a screen of snow and I honestly didn't know if the adults were any kind of real danger because they were all asleep upstairs. So there I lie trembling and in suspense. Finally, I heard the back screen door slam and I remember thinking that he was definitely trying to trick me, so I continued to lie in wait for a few moments more. Suddenly, the calm that I felt before I drifted off to sleep and once again entered the room. Now I could hear the humming of the box fan that was once in the window now laying on the floor, along with the rapid beating of my heart. It was then that I noticed there was no more footsteps or other movements in the room, so slowly I turned my head towards the floor to see if my siblings and cousins were okay. Then I began to scream as loud as I could. I raced up the stairs immediately, waking my mother and everyone else, and I almost fainted in my mother's arms. Before July 31st, 1985, I was never afraid of the dark. As a matter of fact, I preferred to lie in total darkness with my eyes wide open with vivid imaginations until I would fall asleep. Now, I always sleep with the light in the hallway or the bathroom, but never again in total darkness. I could no longer imagine that I was a princess in a castle or a ballerina dance on a ballroom floor because it was hard to pretend to be beautiful and carefree in the dark. The dark is where my innocence was abused and taken by the force of the hands of a total stranger. The stranger that attacked you that night made me realize that evil and great danger can lurk in the dark. However, I am thankful that my grandmother taught me that no matter how evil or brave things may seem, whether in darkness or light, that the power of Jesus can heal and deliver us from anything. I am a living witness. That was my story. I was, like I said, I was brutally raped at 13 by a stranger and got home through a downstairs window. I had no idea where he came from, why he chose me, why he attacked me the way he did. The police were called and they took statements from me and the evidence from the crime scene. I was taken to Park Memorial Hospital, which is the county hospital for Dallas, Texas, and there is where a rape kit was completed. Although the evidence of his similar fluid was found on me and my clothing, the case was suspended. To me, the case was closed because nothing happened after that. And that case went cold for over 20 years. Life after rape, life as a victim was miserable. Although I smiled for all the cameras, I was never the same. I attempted suicide twice. I had extreme paranoia. I trusted no man, not even my father. I was bitter. I was hateful. I was crass, depressed. Anxiety, guilt was my character. I lived in extreme fear. Because my rapist came in through a window, I did not want to live in a house with windows. When I got married, if you could put me in a room where it was just four walls, I would be happy. If you left a window up all night with me in that room, I would cry until I cried myself to sleep. I would act out, like, just act out, trying to get some sort of attention, someone to help me. My family, I now say that my family was ignorant, and I say that because they were not aware of the help that a victim needs after being a victim of sexual violence. So they didn't get any resources or reach out to me. They just figured everything would be okay. I had eating problems. This is ways that I tried to comfort myself from being a victim, and my behavior and my performance at school were deplorable. I started out as a straight-A student. My school and schooling and my education was important to me at first. I knew that one day I was going to be an attorney. I was accepted into law and in high school. They went for my grades from grade school because this is one of my desires that I had as a child. All of that was literally destroyed after being a victim of sexual assault. But enough was enough. I couldn't take it anymore. I couldn't take the anxiety. I couldn't take the stress. I was losing my hair. I was gaining the weight. I couldn't take the fear. I couldn't stand anymore. Not people walking up behind me without me getting jittery or suspecting everyone was about to do something. I couldn't take the shame anymore, feeling like rape was tattooed across my forehead and everybody just looked at me as a nasty person, a guilty person, because I gave myself to a man before marriage. The need to control situations and others. Because I felt I lost all of my control of that night, I felt now I have to try to control everybody else and everything that surrounds me. My perception as a self-victim, clinging and smothering. I know they got on people's nerves. My insecurities, feeling I was inadequate. I'll never be anything. I'll never be able to do anything. My life will never be the same. I'm destined to be nothing. I'll probably end up on welfare with a bunch of children and all of that. I mean, this is deeper in my thoughts of being a victim. Dysfunctional relationship. Every thug, every hood rat, every rascal that my mom used to call them, I was attracted to because I never thought that I deserved anything better. And then finally, when I got married and met my husband, who's a wonderful man, when I saw that I was causing too many problems and conflicts with that and not American problems, I knew that it was time for me to choose another path. So I went on a journey of healing. Like I said, I didn't have the resources, which I truly recommend now as an advocate of rape crisis centers and counseling and therapists or what have you. I didn't have the resources. I didn't know they were available to me. So I had to go back to my first zone, which is my faith. It was something that I was taught as a child. I'm trying to sell it to everybody, although it is free. But I began to write my feelings on paper. Now I've learned that therapists tell us these are good ways of journaling, expressing ourselves and releasing the anger. I took long drives with my husband because, like I said, I took this right into my marriage, the pain and the trauma from being a victim of sexual assault. And we would just talk about some of the things that happened to me, and it was like, I know it was like beating a dead horse, but I had to find some sort of relief from this. I began to nurture myself more. I accepted who I was, and I began to love me. But during all of this journey, I still wanted closure from who it was that sexually assaulted me. Through all my healing, through all my pain, through all my suffering, that was the one thing that stayed in the back of my mind. Who was this monster that entered my house on that night and took something from me that did not belong to him? And during my healing, after my healing, I decided I wanted to help others. So in 2004, I decided to put all of my writings and my poetry in a book entitled Breathe Again. And during this process, I went to my husband. I remember asking him, I said, Ricky, what I think a great topic to close the chapter to my book would be if I could put in there who it was that assaulted me. And I remember how he looked at me because I had outside, I left that alone. I don't know if he thought that this would open up a can of worms and start something all over again. So he told me, he said, pray about it. That's exactly what I did. And in May 2005, there was an article in the Dallas Morning newspaper about the Sexual Assault Cold Case Program initiative that the Dallas Police Department was starting up. And at that point in time, I knew it was time for me to get my final release. The article was about CCAP, called CCAP, for the Sexual Assault Cold Case Program, where victims had to be interested in the status of their case and which to pursue. Part of the reason they did it this way was this all spinoff from the Debbie Smith Act, that was initiated in the United States, which was the federal funding to have these DNA cases reopened from Debbie Smith, she's also a survivor of sexual assault. But the reason why they put it in the paper this way is because of the funding, and they just couldn't go back and open up everybody's cases. We had to do a request to them that we wanted our cases reopened. The crime has to occur between 1970 and 1990. Of course, you have to report to the crime has to report to the outcome.